to Malmö, the 20th ECSS Congress. I'm Susanna Herrenborg.
And I'm Holger Radman, and we are the Congress presidents.
We represent a big group of people who've been working with this conference. It has been a collaboration between colleagues at Copenhagen University, Lund University, and Malmö University. The teamwork has made this a truly multidisciplinary congress.
Right now, we are in the new bright new Malmö Concert Hall, not yet officially opened. It opened actually in August this year. And we'd like to thank Malmö City especially for this. We have just listened to the Malmö University Choir, headed by Daniel Hansson. During this opening ceremony, we will listen to the choir a few times. You may know that choir singing is very popular within the Nordic countries. Only in Sweden, more than 600,000 people sing in choirs. And you have probably heard that choir singing is healthy for the singers, except for being a beautiful experience for the audience.
We're happy to see you all here. There are, however, some absent friends that we would like to recognize. And you will see in the program that we have devoted sessions to the memory of Bengt Saltin and to Lars Magnus Engström. Both of them, two of the 14 founders of ECSS. 5 years ago, in 2010, when we applied for the conference, that was at the initiative of Bengt Saltin, and now we're finally here.
Yeah, ECSS was founded in Nice in February 1995, and it has proved to be a successful story for multidisciplinary academic meetings concerned with sport research. Now participants come from all over the world. For the Congress, here in Malmö, we have representatives from more than 70 countries. One of the sessions will focus on the actual development of sports science in our Congress. In charge of this is Chan Kameen, another founding member.
The theme of this conference is sustainability. On the way out of this concert hall, I hope you can pick up a green water bottle, because we would like to avoid bottled water. I think the first time we had one of the meetings with Malmö City here at our university, we had ordered bottled water, and then Karin Karlsson, who was the president or the organizer of the European Song Contest, she came to us to talk about sustainable conferences, walking in to the room, looking around, saying, well, first thing, Malmö has really good tap water, use it, don't use bottled water, so please, use our tap water instead of the bottled ones. We have also asked you to request lunches. That is for the same reason. In previous conferences, there has been a wastage of food. We would like to avoid that too.
In Malmö Live, this Congress Center, the Concert Hall, is a sustainable, newly opened green project. The intention is to develop the area with as little environmental impact as possible. For example, by reducing energy consumption and using local energy sources such as geothermal heating, solar energy and wind power. Green roofs absorb water, slow up runoff and promote biodiversity. Solar cells meet some of the building's energy requirements. Food waste is collected and turned into biogas and into the green buses you can see here in Malmö. And there are nesting boxes for kestrels on their roofs to help the bird of prey to live in a city environment.
Malmö is a fair trade city, actually the first one in Sweden, from 2006. And a city that has worked extensively with the sustainability questions relating to energy use in urban development. Every fourth journey in Malmö is made by a bike. Soon everyone will be recycling organic waste. Apple cores become biogas for buses, and we use wind power. Well, for those of you who came by the train from Copenhagen, you may have seen the big windmill park between our two countries.
Yeah, and today, sustainability is a question that has to be understood in many different ways. The environmental perspective is only one of them. A sustainable social and economic development is equally important as it is related to equality and health. Sustainability also runs through the Academic Congress program. You will listen to sessions on physiology, biomechanics, social science, and the humanities, all related to the theme. Questions will be posed about elite sport and sport for all, gender, health, inequality, governance of sport, and the use of animals in sport. There is also a session on the technology of sport, a growing field within the sports sector. So not least connected to sustainability questions. The sustainable body will be discussed from an individual as well as an organization perspective.
Now we would like to introduce the first speaker, and that is the State Secretary Agneta Karlsson. Agneta works as State Secretary to the Swedish Minister for Healthcare, Public Health and Sport. Please, Agneta.
Still argue.
Thank you very much, all participants, ladies and gentlemen, very welcome to Sweden and also of course to the beautiful city of Malmö. We were talking about the weather, and even if I'm a politician, there are things we can do as politicians, but the weather is one of the things we cannot really try to change or intervene in any ways. But anyway, I hope you will have very beautiful days here in the town of Malmö. I am of course very glad and honored to be here today as a representative for the Swedish government and the Ministry of Health and Social Affairs. Unfortunately, the Minister Gabriel Wikström couldn't attend himself because he is actually traveling home from Canada now. He's been there to support the Swedish soccer team in the FIFA World Cup, but it didn't go so well for the Swedish women then. Anyway, he was there and so he couldn't be here today. As was said in the introduction, our ministry is now responsible for issues concerning welfare of the society. It's about public health, healthcare, social care, pension, social security, but also gender issues, the rights of the children and the disabled persons, etc. But last year, when the new Swedish government was starting, the Swedish Prime Minister formed his new government, and he decided that the Minister of Health and Social Welfare should also be the hosting the sport issues. And that is for the first time in Sweden's governmental history, sport is now a part of the Minister of Health and Social Affairs. And I think for many of you, and also for me and my minister, that is absolutely natural, because this is where sports belongs in many ways. Because it is really an issue of public health. And health and physical activity, as was mentioned here just in the formal introduction, is really linked together. And of course we're very proud of being able to work together with these very important areas together. But sport also has another very important dimension and also objective for the Swedish sport policy. That is the democratic perspective. Getting people to engage and assume responsibility in non-profit activities within the sport movement's organization on different levels is also very important, and also an important part of a democratic society. So Swedish sport policy is about supporting a free and independent sports movement. And alongside our free and independent sports movement, we also have an equally free and independent sports science. A long-standing Nordic and Swedish history of prominent scholars, helping of course sport, but also us as politicians to better understand sport and the sports movement. And I am assured, I already know that by experience, that we will have a lot to do and we need a lot of help for the sports researchers in Sweden now when we are going to intertwine health policy and sports. So therefore I'm extra pleased to have been invited to this gathering of sports scientists in a truly multidisciplinary setting. As I said, sport is a priority for the Swedish government. Getting people to take part in sports and supporting our sports movement is very important. In Sweden, as in our Nordic neighboring countries, overall health of our people is pretty good, and we see improvement in many areas. In Sweden, for example, the risk of heart attacks has been cut by 25% in the last 30 years. We live longer, and we can also see that we put healthier years to life in general. But we can also see that today, a woman with a university degree can expect to live a full 5 years longer than a young woman who left school at 16. And we can also see that today it's 5 years difference, and 15 years ago it was 4 years. So we can see in some aspects we're moving in the wrong direction, and we can see that the inequalities in health is getting worse in some senses. And for us, it's totally clear that access to sport and good health should not be based on where you live or where you come from. It should not be based on social status, gender or education. So therefore, our government has set a clear goal and direction for the nation's health policy. That is to eliminate such avoidable health inequalities within a generation. And I think some of you might recognize that from the former WHO commission that was led by Sir Michael Marmot a few years ago. So we are now appointing a Swedish Commission on Equity in Health, and it will work for 2 years, analyzing and preparing concrete proposals for the short term, for the medium term, and for the generation term on how to close this inequality gap in health. And the Commission also has instructions to work closely with the sports movement and of course also with the scientific community. And I'm very much looking forward to follow this urgent work. As I said, sport is a priority for this government, but it's not solely for public health reasons. It is also, as I said, an important element in our democratic welfare system. I would argue that as its best, the sports movement generates both social trust and space for radical individualism. And that is two elements that makes Nordic countries well equipped to deal with fundamental challenges like sustainability in general. We know, for instance, that social trust and trust in institutions co-vary with low levels of corruption. Our Swedish state support to sport and to the sports movement intends to strengthen sport. We believe that public funding for sports needs no further reason than to support the organization and the movement. The Swedish Sports Confederation is entrusted to allocate all state funding for sport with only general instruction, that is, sport for all, gender equality, children's rights, and a few more. This trust between the state and our independent sports movement is of course not without some problems, but these problems are remarkably few, I would say. The Swedish sports movement consists of more than 3 million members, and that is on a population that is 9 million people, organized into more than 20,000 local sports clubs. All of these sports clubs are public, non-profit organizations, meaning they are democratic and open to anyone who wants to join. And the sports clubs' operations are largely based on unpaid volunteer work. And over 650,000 coaches, educators, and elected officials, many of them parents of children and young athletes, make it possible. And therefore 90% of all children and young people in Sweden are or have been members of a sports club. These facts and figures makes working with sports policy so relevant for the government. Sport brings people closer. Sport brings meaning to life for many of us. It's about entertainment, it's about inclusion, and it's, in many ways, a very positive thing to do. But there are also some worrisome things and some things that we have to really t- take responsibility for all of us. I'm very pleased to know that the good governance in sport is on the agenda here in Malmö. I mentioned before that social trust co-vary with low levels of corruption. Unfortunately, there seems to be low levels of social trust in certain parts of the sporting world. Good governance and good ethics in sport is so elementary in our Nordic countries. You don't easily cheat in a popular movement. Of course, we have had our share of cheaters and charlatans, and we still have. And I certainly don't say that the good governance and good ethics in sports are absent in the rest of the world. But I actually do believe that the Nordic, well, not only Nordic model, but with non-profit and democratic sports club is more resistant to corruption, match fixing, doping and racism, etc. A model where a sport is responsible for sport. The Swedish sports movement adheres to the UN's Universal Declaration of the Human Rights, the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, and the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. In order to sustain, the sporting world also must adhere to universal principles. Sport cannot be a playground. International sport must commit to respecting relevant international standards. Committing to the 10 principles of the UN Global Compact would be an obvious step forward. This means operating in ways that, at a minimum, meet fundamental responsibilities in the areas of human rights, labor, environment, and anti-corruption. People around the world deserve good governance in sport. Ladies and gentlemen, I touched upon some subjects of particular interest for me as a politician, and I realize that this Congress will cover so much more and so many more interesting and relevant issues. I truly hope that you will all have an outstanding, interesting and successful Congress here in Malmö, where you can develop the broad perspective of sustainable sport. Thank you very much.
Let's run more cover.
Thank you, Daniel and Malmö University Choir.
Did you recognize the song? Was the ECSS, no, it was the European Song Contest winner of this year. And this song, Heroes, was sang by Måns Zelmerlöw in the competition. And he grew up in Lund, only 16 kilometers from Malmö. In sports, there are many heroes. Some of them top athletes and coaches in Sweden, like Zlatan Ibrahimovic, Pia Sundhage, Ingmar Stenmark, Charlotte Kalla, Björn Borg, Annika Sörenstam. But there are heroes on all levels, as Agneta talked about previously. Not the least, approximately 3 million members in the Swedish Sports Confederation. And 90% of all children and young people in Sweden have been or are members of a sports association. Coaches and leaders work, like you just heard, on a voluntary basis.
And now I would like to introduce our next speaker, the acting Vice Chancellor of Malmö University. You have also a background in one of the biggest schools in Sweden, Equestrian Sport. And the board is yours. Welcome, Cecilia Kristersson.
Welcome, and you know you are in the hometown of Zlatan Ibrahimovic, and you can sense it's almost wherever you're going now, but this is the hometown of Zlatan. But there are of course other people around here too. So dear honorary guests, dedicated presenters and devoted participants, on behalf of Malmö University, Lund University and the University of Copenhagen, I have the honor to welcome you all to this 20th annual Congress of the European College of Sports Science held here in the middle heart of Malmö City. Well, you know that Malmö goes quite a long way back. It was founded around 1275, and at that time this part of Sweden was actually belonging to the Kingdom of Denmark. And of course these countries were fighting a lot, and there was a lot of war going on. Around 1658, there was a treaty, and Malmö, this part became the Sweden. Since then, we have never had basically any war, and that's quite unique. We are very, of course, thankful for having that sort of peaceful place to grow in. And since 2000, these two countries are, of course, happily connected with a beautiful bridge that I think most of you passed while you were coming in from the Copenhagen airport to come to Malmö. Malmö is a very interesting place, and I usually check out a little here, and I'm going to do that again. How many of you have been to Malmö before? Quite many of you have not been here. So I think I want to tell you a little story for you to get the sense. It's just going to be very short, but I think it will give you sort of a sense of what kind of city you are in. It is the third largest city in Sweden if you count on the number of inhabitants. Around 300,000 people live here in Malmö. But it's a quite interesting pot of people here. It is a young city in the sense that half of the population is actually under the age of 35. So yes, there is a lot of sports going on here, and for a long time, I believe. 41% of the population actually have a foreign background, and 30% is born in another country. In 2011, we had counted here that we had a representatives for 174 countries, and about 150 different languages were spoken here in Malmö. That's quite unique, and if you go to the schools, I think it's about 40 different languages spoken. So when you go around in the city, I think wherever you are from, you will hear your hometown. According to the OECD, Malmö comes in the strong fourth place when it comes to number of patent application per 10,000 inhabitants. So this is a city of innovation, and I hope you also will get a sense and a little flair of innovation in Malmö. If you are looking for the most bike-friendly city on the planet, the most bike-friendly city on the planet, you are absolutely in the right spot of the world, because Copenhagen is taking number one place in the world. So I hope you will get the chance to go biking in Copenhagen. Malmö has sort of dropped down a little. We were, I think, on the third place, but now on the sixth. So even in Malmö, it could be fun to go biking while you are here. The bridge is, of course, a landmark of Malmö, but you will also find the beautiful architectural building, Turning Torso, which is actually the highest building in Sweden and in the Nordic countries. It's called the Turning Torso, and was built by the architect Santiago Calatrava. Malmö has a story. It's not only been joyful and wonderful, it has been also tough city to live in. It was an industrial city with recession, and the industry went actually down. We had a very devoted and dedicated mayor, Ilmar Reepalu, who actually also was an architect by chance, and he also sort of sketched out where Malmö would be in the future. He was the mayor for 25 years, and you can see that he had a very good sense for architecture and what the city is all about. And we can see that in the building we are very much in here now, and the buildings around. So Malmö needed to change and shift from a city in recession to a growing center of culture and knowledge. And that was a political decision to make a university in Malmö. And that was in 1998. So beside the old sister university in Lund, which was born in 1666, we now came to have a new university here in Malmö in 1998. And of course that was supposed to be different from the old traditional university. Here we wanted to create programs and education that was multidisciplinary, that was very close in addressing social issues, and also very close to the needs of the society. Today we have 25,000 students and 1,600 employees. And from the beginning, the vision of Malmö University was that diversity makes a difference. And of course, being in the middle of this fantastic multicultural city that Malmö is, that was very important for us. And we have really stuck on to that vision, to work on an open university. 70% of our students actually are the first generations of academics. And as I mentioned before, 30% of our students has a non-Swedish background. But it's also good to know that our students, to about 90%, actually get employed after they take their degrees at the university. But Malmö University is engaged in society, and we believe that we should be, both with our research and our education, be close with partners in the region. Strategically, we have chosen to be a challenge-based and multidisciplinary education and research center, and to emphasize that we need collaborative processes to actually solve our global challenges. With this in mind, it is therefore quite natural that these three hosting universities collectively support the theme of this conference, sustainable sport, emphasizing the importance of sustainability in education and research. Also, the important role of sports for democracy, equity, entrepreneurship, and of course, physical and mental health aspects. It is very impressive, I think, that this conference has attracted 2,500 participants from 70 different countries covering all continents. That's only to be congratulating on that. With 1,595 presentations offered, it seems that the conference could successfully be extended for quite many more days, maybe so the weather turns to sunshine. I will finally, of course, address special thanks to the Executive Board, the members of the Local Scientific Committee, reviewers, and especially to the Congress Presidents, Susanna Henebo and Åger Wadman, both from Malmö University, and all the members of the Local Organizing Committee, who almost throughout a full year have worked hard to coordinate and make this happen. And finally, but not the least, we're grateful for the contributions of all the voluntary students coming from about 20 different countries. You make us all feel at home and make us feel welcome throughout the Congress. So, I wish you a great stay here in Malmö, where I hope you will learn together, you will network together, you will of course have lots of fun together, but most of all, get together to find new challenging projects for future sustainable solutions that actually will make a difference. So best wishes for a successful Congress 2015, and you are always mostly welcome back to Malmö anytime. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cecilia. And now I think we have to prepare the stage for what is going to happen next. How many of you watched the ECS's Malmö movie? Raise a hand. Maybe 40%? Can't see you all. Anyway, if you missed the movie, now you see very soon on stage the best part of it. So I leave the floor for Malmö Flickorna. Thank you. Tack så mycket. Thank you very much. Malmöflickorna. Wow. So exciting to finally see all of you here. My name is Michaela, and this is my colleague Joakim. We work together at the Department of Sports Science here at Malmö University.
Yes, and we are here to tell you about the ECSS 20th anniversary program of social and physical activities. Ooh, that's long.
It's a long name.
But before that, we have to say something about Malmöflickorna. Malmöflickorna was founded in 1954, and the ball routine you saw in the movie is one of their trademarks. They have been performing it in over 1,700 times in 36 countries all over the world.
Okay, that's a lot of numbers. But we're here to tell you about the program of social and physical activities. What is that? Can you explain?
Well, it's a program, as you said, about social and physical activities. There are 12 activities going on from all the conference. We're doing everything from running on the beach, to having yoga in the morning outside here, to having a tour of the canal with a guided boat, to mingling at the bull bar. We are going on a guided tour about Sporting Women of Malmö. And then, of course, we're gonna do the running race on Friday in the memory of Bengtsson team.
Cool, I like it. I'm in, I'm definitely in. But if I would like to know more about the different activities, the 12 different activities, how can I know that and how can I sign up?
Well, there's information all over. We have information in the information desk. There's information on the website, and that's also where you sign up for different activities. And when it comes to the Bengtsson team run, it's almost full, but there is a few places left. You can sign up for them tomorrow between 4 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the evening by the information desk. And that's also where the ones of you who's already in the race pick up your name tags. And if you don't want to pick them up at 6 in the morning on the same day as the run, anyway. Okay?
Okay. But now we know what it is and what kind of different activities. But why do we have a program like this? Do you know?
Well, for a number of reasons. First of all, it's very important, I think, to have a chance to get to know each other, to have some discussions in more formal circumstances. But also, it's a long conference, you have to keep the circulation going. Okay, but if you want even more information, where do you turn?
You can, of course, talk with us later, after the opening ceremony. And you can also find our email addresses in the program. And tomorrow at 6 o'clock in the evening, you can also find us running together with Malmö Gorilla Runners at the beach here at Riba. Because you're going to be there, right?
Okay, so about the balls. How many of you were in Amsterdam last year? Raise a hand. Okay, if some of you may remember when we had the last talk at the end of the conference, we threw some balls into the audience and asked you to catch them, and if you caught them and brought them here, you would get a gift. So is there any balls who have found their way back from Malmö? Raise your hand. Where?
Well over there.
Well done, well done. An applause. Of course. So you can collect your gift in the Malmö University booth in the exhibition area whenever you want during the conference. We haven't thought about it. Yeah.
Okay, I think that was actually all from us. So I hope you'll have a nice conference and a nice evening, and we'll see you out there.
Oh, It's wonderful to be here and really welcome to the 20th and it's the ETSS Congress, 2015 Congress of Mali. This is our 20th anniversary. It's a special occasion because the college was founded in 1995, and here today we are celebrating its 20th anniversary. Also, I'd like to thank the State Secretary, Greta Carlson, for your kind words and for being here, for your support. The Vice Chancellor, Cecilia Christensen, for your presence, your support, very appreciated. And of course, congratulations for your very hard work to our Congress Presidents, Susanna Ellenberg and Javier Radman. Well done. I think we all enjoyed tremendously the opening ceremony. It was really wonderful and it's so beautiful to see the young people so coordinated, much more coordinated than the president. But it's just wonderful. And the choir, as an Italian, I can appreciate music and certainly it was outstanding. But of course, we are not only celebrating the 20th anniversary of the CSS, but we are also commemorating the disappearance of the founder, one of the founders of the CSS, Professor Benxantin. Well, Professor Benxantin was a very keen sportsman, and he really, truly believed in sports science, deep in his heart. He actually coined the term, humans were meant to move, and I think this term should, from now on, become the motto of the CSS. So, of course, this Congress is, as usual, as all the CSS Congresses, it's a multidisciplinary Congress with a good proportion of life sciences, in which we excel, and also a good proportion of social sciences and humanities. And particularly here in Malmo, social sciences and humanities is very strong, so there is a very good representation this year, so we are very proud of that. And we should all remember that our college has core disciplines, and we always make an effort to make sure that all core disciplines are duly represented. I speak as a physiologist, but I fully admire and respect the other disciplines because always there is much to learn from an integrative approach, from a multidisciplinary approach. This, in a way, the European College is the best example of a working European Union and beyond, because actually we have representation from 74 countries with, believe it or not, the top attendant, top participant is Japan. So, I'd like to congratulate you. A Japanese delegation for making the effort to fly all the way once again to attend the conferences. But of course, it is a welcome to all participants because we really value this international profile of this CSS. But without further ado, it is my task, actually it is the easiest task, that was announcing the opening of the Congress. So I declare the 2015 Congress, CSS Congress, open. Thank you.
Thank you, Marco. And it's so nice to see you all here in Malmö. And the only thing I'm going to say now is to welcome you to reception and have great 4 days here in Malmö. Have fun and keep networking. Thank you all.